Good evening. On behalf of Dr. M.G.R. Janaki College of Arts and Science for Women, I welcome you all for this national webinar by industry experts organized by the departments of biochemistry, microbiology, and PG departments of applied microbiology, bioinformatics, and clinical trial management. This national seminar for today and tomorrow is delivered by illustrious industry experts from the science fields. The talk would be highly informative on the latest techniques and industry opportunities, which will definitely pave way for the students and research scholars in their career. A warm welcome to the speaker of the day, Dr. Venkata Subbulakshmi, founder and managing director, Darthi Healthcare Technologies Private Limited, Bangalore, who is here to present the talk. I thank the eminent speakers for accepting our invitation to share their experience and knowledge. We express our sincere thanks to our correspondent, Dr. Lata Rajendran, Chairman Mr. Kumar Rajendran, for supporting us in all our endeavors. We thank our Principal, Dr. Manimeklai, Vice Principal, Dr. Lakshmi Balaji, Dean Students, Dr. Apita Sabapati, and Dean Academics, Dr. Shanti Lakshmi, who has always been a support to us. I would like to thank all the staff members of the Departments of Biochemistry and Microbiology for organizing the webinar. I now request Ms. Deepa, Assistant Professor, Department of Biochemistry, to introduce our speaker.
Good evening. A warm welcome to all the participants for the first day of this webinar. It is a great pleasure for me to introduce Dr. Venkata Subbulakshmi, Founder and Managing Director, Darthi Healthtech Technologies Private Limited. She has completed a bachelor's and master's in agriculture and doctorate in life sciences from Bose Institute. Dr. Venkata Subbulakshmi was a research fellow in Cleveland Clinic Foundation, Ohio, USA. Following that, she was a research scientist in AstraZeneca, India. She was a director in Chromis Biotech Private Limited, Bangalore, India. And now she is the founder and managing director, Darthi Healthcare Technologies Private Limited. She has over 12 international research papers and 2 book chapters to her credits. She is a recipient of many awards, and to name a few, she has received the prestigious Endowment Fellowship from Madras Fertilizers Limited during a master's degree, Senior Research Fellowship from CSIR Government of India, the Excellence Award in the year 2004 by AstraZeneca, Best Performance Team Award in 2010 by AstraZeneca. With a rich experience, she has served as a resource person, as an invited speaker in national and international conferences. Before I hand over this session to Dr. Venkata Subbulakshmi, a few instructions to the participants. Participants, kindly post your name and college name in the chat box. The attendance links will be posted in the chat box during both the days. Kindly fill it and send it. Feedback link will be sent tomorrow during the end of the session. If you have any relevant questions, please post it in the chat box. Ma'am, I now hand over the session to you.
Okay. Thank you so much for the kind introduction, and glad to be here interacting with you students. And so today we'll be talking about the various areas of life sciences and what are the opportunities available. What holds in future for you. I have 30 years of experience in life science area, so I'd like to share some of my so-called wisdom with you guys, so that it is useful to you in your coming years. So let's go to the presentation. So the opportunities in life sciences, anything in life, when you ask, why I want it, so what are my choices, how I go about getting it, if you can answer these three questions, you're there. The why of anything is your thought process. So your thought process has to be clear, why do I want to do this, or why do I want to do a job at all? And then once you decide, yes, I want to do a job, then you think, what are my choices? And then how to go about getting it? So let's talk about, the why part of it. Do I want a job or I want a career? you know, job will make you financially independent and then it will fulfill your short-term goals. But, you know, thinking long-term, the career, so it will make you, of course, financially independent and you will have a vision and you will be fulfilling a purpose in your life. So I would rather, you know, encourage you guys to think about in terms of your career, like what you want to do in your life. And so the recipe for a successful career is, remember, you should have a good cat. So what do I mean by the cat? So you should have a good choice, good attitude, and toil hard for it. So there are three things, right? What are the choices that you have? And how do I approach with the right attitude? And how do I work hard to get that? So what are the choices you have after you complete your graduation, post-graduation and PhD? You have two streams open, either academia or industry. And in academia, what do you have? You can either go for teaching students or you can take up teaching as well as research. So for both of which you need a PhD. So after post-graduation, you will do a PhD. And then, you know, there are various pathways to get to that. Like you will write a UGC NET exam, CSAR, GATE, several which give you a fellowship to do PhD. And so once you choose whether you want to be in academia or industry, you know, you made your choice, like academia or industry. And in industry, there are like for life science students, there's a pharma and biotechnology. The whole of life sciences, you know, industry can be classified into two streams, either pharma or biotechnology. Pharma is basically which has a biomedical application, anything related to medicine. And anything not related to medicine or even related to medicine comes under this biotechnology industry. So what all this pharma industry, you know, is involved in? It's involved in cell and gene therapy and recombinant protein therapeutics and the microRNA, small RNA, and the stem cell research, gene expression profiling, nanotechnology, molecular forming, genotyping. So these are all the various aspects of the pharma industry, pharma as well as biotechnology industry. And so when we talk about the first one, cell and gene therapy. So what is available in this area? Like, you know, there are like few diseases caused by genetic disorder only. Even cancer, it's a genetic disorder. So hemophilia B, cystic fibrosis, muscular dystrophy, sickle cell anemia, SCID. You know, these are some of the diseases which are genetic disorders. So the pharma industry is either involved in making products which can detect it, like a diagnostics, or making product to cure it. So therapeutics. So when we talk about cell and gene therapy, so one example, let's take SCID. It is an autoimmune disease. So the gene which is responsible for this autoimmune disease is ADA. And the RNA copy of that, so how do they treat it? How about going if this gene therapy goes? So the RNA copy of the human ADA gene is packed into the viral genome. So this viral genome, you know, goes and integrates into the human, the patient system itself. So it goes and integrates with the T cells. So T cells they are treated to proliferate using IL-2. It is a cytokine, interleukin-2. So this treatment is repeated every 6 to 8 months because the T cells get replenished, and that's the life cycle. T cells get replenished every 6 to 8 months. So in 2002, there were two young SCID patients were treated with their own blood stem cells, that have been transformed in vitro with a retroviral vector carrying that ADA gene. So it is the first of the gene therapy which is successful gene therapy, which has been performed. And after a year, both the children have a normal, you know, life. Like they are cured of SCID. So that's one success story. So the another area which is the pharma industry is working is, you know, recombinant human protein therapeutics, recombinant protein. So there are more than 50 proteins are produced industrially. So the major success include myoglobin, calcitonin, and, you know, insulin. Like almost every family has a diabetic patient who's using, you know, insulin and protein C, protein S, collagen, etc. And also growth factors, interleukins, monoclonal antibodies, GCF, colony-stimulating factor, interferons. You know, these are being used, these monoclonal antibodies are being used for cancer treatment. So the major hosts include bacteria, yeast, and virus, you know. So, so that is another area of pharma. And so going to the third, you know, the next area of you know, application in the pharma industry is there's something called microRNA and small interfering RNA, siRNA. So these are, you know, these are the sequence specific in a small RNA which are used. These are homologous mRNA producing. They can be used to knock down the cells. So it so the small interfering RNA design, the tools can be used to target a specific gene, and which can be used for, you know, treating cancer or as a biomarker or in diagnostics. And also the another popular area now is getting, you know, a lot of attention is stem cell research. So what are the stem cells? The stem cells are the ones like which are produced in our bone marrow, and then differentiate into diverse range of specialized cell types. Like it, you can drive a particular, you know, stem cell to any other type of cell with a proper, you know, cytokine induction. Or with various growth factors. So, but a lot of ethical issues are involved. While there are a lot of very good advantage, like you can do a bone marrow transplant, especially for leukemia treatment, stem cells, you know, can come into a big play, and Parkinson's disease can be treated, spinal cord injuries can be treated, multiple sclerosis disease can be treated. And also, but the only thing is, like there are the scientists are divided in terms of, you know, especially ethical. Is it ethical to do the human cloning using stem cells? And so it's kind of debatable. And so it's so the progress is kind of slow in this area. So another major area, which is being you know, used and applied every day, is gene expression profiling. You all might have heard about next gen sequencing, next generation sequencing, where your human genome can be, you know, mapped, and it can be your gene expression can be profiled. So if anybody has, you know, cancer or genetic disease, if they do the gene expression profiling, they can be diagnosed with like what exactly went wrong, or which expression of genes is, you know, affected. So they can come up with a diagnostic as well as therapeutic, you know, treatment for it. So here is the where it is of very good interest for bioinformatics students, because this gene expression, like the NGS, it generates a lot of data like through microarray or bioinformatics. So bioinformatics is the place where you can you analyze and then compare the data sequence, looking at the gene expression pattern, the sequencing data. So this is of a great interest for bioinformatics students. So this is kind of you know, very brief or representative, or a very crisp representative of how gene expression profiling is done. And you will be learning you know, in your classes more about it. I'm not going into the technical detail of it right now, because our topic is like, what are all the options available in the life sciences. So NGS, gene expression profiling, is one major area which has the prospects for life sciences and bioinformatics students. So it generates data something like this. And so let's move to the another area which has like in fashion, we can say nanotechnology. So what is it, nanotechnology? You know, nanotechnology, it's so nanoparticles are development of particles of 100 nanometer with varieties of properties. So you're to compare the sizes of you know, the general things that we know of. The carbon-carbon bond length is 12 to 15 nanometer, and DNA helix, double helix diameter is 2 nanometer, and the mycoplasma is 200 nanometer. So the nanoparticles are produced with the, you know, two different approaches. They call that bottom-up approach or top-down approach, either by synthetic chemistry or by molecular assembly. And so there are like different approaches to make nanoparticles. So what are these applications for this nanoparticles? So more than 1,000 nanoproducts are marketed now in the market, and then 4 to 5 hits every week. And there is a titanium nanoparticle in the sunscreen, and there is silver in food processing, silver nanoparticle, zinc oxide in cosmetics, and there is nanoparticle based water purifier also. And in the current situation, TNAU, like my alumni university, they have developed a nanoparticle based you know, hand sanitizer for this COVID problem and all that. Their nanotechnology department is doing a very good research, and apparently that has more you know, effective in hand sanitization, more than 30 minutes. So I encourage you to look into their website for their, you know, product information. So this nanotechnology,
we are very sorry for the technical inconvenience. We are trying to connect to the speaker as soon as possible. I kindly request the participants to stay. We are connecting the speaker in a few minutes.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, ma'am. We can hear you, ma'am.
Okay. So you want me to go over the slides? From which slide onwards you want me to go over?
Ma'am, the same slide that is being projected now, ma'am. You please continue with that, ma'am.
Okay, fine. Okay, so we are here. So we are talking about molecular farming. So what is molecular farming? Is the usage of plants and animals to synthesize novel products of therapeutic value on a large scale. So the active biomolecule is expressed in a different host. And why? Because it is easy and convenient purification protocol. So production of drugs or vaccines or growth factors are being done this way. And it is a low cost, and then you have an unlimited resource to make it, because you can't make the human protein in human, and we can use bacteria or plant or yeast as a source to make all these different drugs or vaccines. And the concern is like, what if whether the gene flow can enter the food chain if you express it in a plant, so it might enter the through seeds, it can enter the food chain. So that is one concern. And what will be the effect on the environment? That's another concern. And so every area has its own pros and cons. And for genotyping technology, it has a lot of application. It has it has grown leaps and bounds in the genotyping technology. There are rapid advances from RFLP to RFPD, AFLP, STR, and microsatellite research. STR-based analysis can distinguish your gene pool or between two individual, whether the DNA is from you or from you know, especially for forensic technology, where they want to know the, you know, where they want to see whether the criminal and they can do the STR-based analysis and then find out. And also evolutionary event analysis can be, you know, done, whether the migration of human within continents, and then who came first, and all that, all with just a drop of blood or a hair follicle or saliva are good enough sources for, you know, DNA isolation and do the STR analysis. So as I mentioned, forensic science, you know, genotyping has a great application in forensic sciences. The individual human identity, it's a genetic tag, you know, can be done. Two interesting stories, you know, being like one state government, they wanted to do the database of all the, you know, DNA sequence of all the criminals so that they have it in the database. So in the, you know, next forensic test, they can use it for screening. And also you paternity test can be used, and then to establish a family relationship, whether two persons or, you know, blood relations or anything, they can, it can be known, screened, and then, you know, tested. And also endangered and protected species DNA sequence can be kept. So this is just to show how the forensic analysis or anything with the paternity test DNA analysis looks like. So now, so what I told you, like, you know, in the to have a good career, you need to think of in terms of CAT: choice, attitude, and toil. So we talked about all the choices that you have in different areas, and we and also, like, you know, for everything, like, you in life, you want to be successful, you need to be patient, you need to be persistent. I mean, never give up. And also perspiration, you have to work hard to get wherever, you know, you want to reach. So I thank you for you know, your attention. And this is my team, this was my team in the U.S. when I was working, and you see, Dr. Kathkett was my mentor and inspiration in several ways. She kind of, I would say, helped me to, you know, mold me in the career, whatever I have. And well, thank you for attention, and I'll be happy to take any question that you might have.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am, for the highly informative talk. Your suggestions for the educational and occupational choices were indeed very revealing. Thank you, ma'am. A few questions on behalf of the participants.
Okay.
Ma'am, would you suggest any diploma or certificate courses in addition to the graduation that our students are doing?
Okay. See, the Biocon, you know, the Biocon is, everybody would have heard about Biocon. They run something called industrial, you know, finishing school, or if you want to work in industry, they run a training program. So more than diploma, I would suggest, you know, to take up all this training school they provide, because they know exactly what kind of you know, training you need for industry. So that is one thing. And of course, the people who want to go to bioinformatics from biochemistry stream or any life sciences, so for bioinformatics there is a 1 year or 2 year courses there.
Okay.
So that can be taken up. And of course, like, no, I want to do, you know, I want to study more, of course, PhD. It's there. There are various ways of going around getting a doctorate.
Hmm? Okay, and ma'am, another question is, what is the scope of medical billing and medical coding industries for the students?
You mean the transcription, you know, they dictate? It's basically a typing job, right? But you need to know the medical terms so that you don't make mistakes. Medical transcription, because in a mainly abroad, and you know, they kind of they don't have time for typing, and then documentation work they outsource it to India, and so we do it at a very low price for them. It's economical for them. So you just want to have a job, then you can go ahead and do it. For that, you don't need any special training. All they want is a life science graduate.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, there's another question from Uma Maheshwari. What about the career choices for life science cross major students, ma'am?
Yeah, cross major means, what do you mean cross major?
Ma'am, like undergraduate and post-graduation in the same, like exactly opposite to it, ma'am. Like graduation, they do it in one department, and the post-graduation, they switch over to another department. Nowadays, people study biochemistry and then they switch on to bioinformatics. So cross-major students, what about their career choices, ma'am?
Actually, it's pretty good. See, what I did post-graduation, I started with, agriculture. Of course, in agriculture, we studied biochemistry, microbiology, statistics, and so many things. And for my MSc, I chose microbiology. Okay. And from microbiology, I went to immunology in my PhD. Okay. So after that, I worked mostly on immunology. So what you do in graduation and post-graduation doesn't matter much. So whatever in life stream, life sciences, they will be considered, you know, almost same. And of course, it's a good scope for biochemistry and, to move from biochemistry to bioinformatics. Like if the person is interested in this big data analysis, gene sequencing data and those things, like somebody may not be interested much in doing wet work in lab. So it is ideal for those people. Like I want to work only with the computer. So good for all those people. Like if you study from biochemistry to MSc biochemistry, then you might be involved mostly in the lab work.
Right.
But if you take up bioinformatics, then you would be using only the computer and those kind of stuff, you know.
Right, ma'am.
So it's good. It depends on the person's interest, I would rather say.
Right. Thank you, ma'am. And another question is, what do you think it is a required qualification for studying abroad or doing the research abroad?
Okay. There are two ways of going about it. Okay. One is you do your post-graduation and go for a PhD, or you go for postdoctoral training to abroad. So that's what I did. Like I completed my PhD in India and went for postdoctoral research. Another is going for PhD itself abroad, like for US and all. They don't accept our post-graduation, okay? Even if you enter for PhD there, you have to do again MS another 5 years of research. So you would, after doing MS here, you would be spending 7 years over for getting a PhD abroad. I would rather suggest after PG here, if you go to Europe, you get PhD in 3 years. They kind of accept, like either Germany or UK, so they accept our post-graduation qualification. So if somebody wants to do PhD, I would rather suggest like they go to Europe for PhD.
Okay. Ma'am, there's a question from Ramesh Srinivasan. The siRNAs as knockdown cells can be used against cancerous cells or even as biomarkers. What is the success rate?
The thing is, it is it's very difficult to make, so that's why it is still not popular. But it's very specific and successful, and still not commercialized yet, and there are a lot of regulatory issues involved as well. But research wise it's very successful.
Okay.
See, it takes almost 12 years for a drug to come into market, you know, from research to come to a market, it takes 12 years and $1 billion investment. And for siRNA, it will take even more than $1 billion investment and more than 12 years. So that's why it's kind of not yet popular. It's still in for research stage, it's very successful.
Okay. And ma'am, another question from the same participant. What is the success rate of gene expression polycancerous patients?
Gene expression? Could you repeat, please?
Yeah. What is the success rate of gene expression in profiling cancerous patients?
It is very successful. You heard of, next generation sequencing like NGS. Earlier, it used to cause, in 90s and 10, 15 years back, it used to cost more than $1 million to sequence your genome. Once, now you, for 10,000 rupees, you can sequence your whole genome. So the technology has improved so much. And they can find out through this gene expression profiling, they can find out which, gene is defective in that particular cancer, or not only one gene, maybe multiple genes are defective. So it's very successful as a diagnostic tool.
Okay. And ma'am, another question. How about cross degree from microbiology to microbial genetics?
It's all life sciences, right? As I told you. Especially for, industry, it doesn't matter. But if you're going into the academics, then you kind of specialize yourself more and more into a narrow area. And for industry, we prefer the person who has a broader, who has studied different areas and who has knowledge in different areas. The person has to choose whether he wants to be in academics or industry. So depending on that, they have to, equip themselves with the knowledge and the skills which are required for that particular stream.
Okay. Ma'am, another question is, what is the demand for freshers in pharma or biotechnical industries?
It's actually, it is pretty high. They prefer to kind of, like a company like us, like startups also, and established companies like Biocon. We prefer freshers because we can train them to the way for the kind of work that we do in our industry, right? So if you do MSc, and if you choose to be in industry, okay, fresh graduates have very good future. But if you choose, you want to be in academics, of course, you have to go for PhD, and there are not much scope for freshers in academia. That's what I would say.
Okay. And ma'am, another question is, what would be the projected job growth of life science in another 20 years?
I would say life sciences and the health sector looks very promising. I would say it's one of the, the pandemic, looking at the silver lining, I would say, because now people realize how much health is important, and the government is also realizing they have to invest so much in, life sciences research. So much funding is being directed for life sciences research now. So I would say it looks pretty good. And earlier, only this celebrities like footballers and actors, they were being paid $1 million. Now I think scientists will get $1 million. So it's like, you know, the, I would say future looks good for life science people.
Ma'am, any clinical research associate positions open in India? How successful can they be?
There are a lot of, there's a whole lot of clinical research, you know, wing in Biocon. It is, because of India's, you know, good skills in the language and as well as, you know, knowledge. So a lot of clinical research by big pharma companies are given to India, and they don't go to, you know, Japan or Germany or other Western countries because of the high cost involved. And Japan, even though technologically very advanced, they have their, you know, their language, like in English, as it's not much. They need to recruit all these translators, you know, to get this job done. So the clinical research in India has a lot of scope, actually.
Ma'am, any short-term courses that are available for microbiology or biochemistry students? Would you suggest any short-term courses?
Yeah, like I think the clinical research, there is a clinical research diploma or something. It's being offered in some private colleges in Bangalore. You need to just Google it. And I would suggest clinical research is one good area. And another good area is, of course, going into the training program for industrial biotechnology, which is being offered by many companies. Even we run a program for MSc students, any stream, either biochemistry or microbiology, to prepare them for industrial research. In molecular biology, we have a training program like for gene cloning, sequencing, and those kind of, you know, hands-on training for on those techniques. So the options are, of course, one is clinical research, and another is getting an industrial biotechnology research training.
Okay. A question from Anusha. Ma'am, can you please give us an idea on 30-day courses available for microbiology students?
30-day course, I think industrial, it's called finishing school, you know, so you can choose. It's being run by ITBT department, Information Technology and Biotechnology Department of Karnataka, KBITS. If you look into the website KBITS, you know, you will get information regarding that.
Okay. Ma'am, another question from a participant. What is the scope of bioinformaticians in medical industries?
Yeah, especially in NGS, I told you, next generation sequencing, then there is a lot of data to be analyzed, and also in clinical research. So there, bioinformaticians are, you know, required.
Okay. Another question from Ashwini Loganathan. What is the scope of life sciences after this COVID-19?
I think I mentioned that before. I would say, it's like the whole world is reset into a different mode, and we are reprioritizing all the, you know, research and what we are, you know, want to do. So the life sciences and healthcare technology is one major sector which is going to get a lot of, you know, funding and attention after this COVID. The coming days, it's going, I mean, it's very good for life sciences graduates to look for, you know, to work in this area. Another one big thing I wanted to mention, not only the academia industry for this MSc student, instead of looking for a job, you know, you have some good idea, be an entrepreneur, you know. And there are a lot of grants which are being given to the freshers with a good idea. Biotechnology, it's something called the BIG, big grant. It is Biotechnology Ignition Grant Scheme. You know, you can find that in the Department of Biotechnology India website, DBT. So, you know, don't look for others for a job. You know, do your own thing. Like if you have some bright idea, I know a company which is started by fresh graduates, M.Tech graduates from IIT. Six of them formed together, and then they formed. It's I don't know whether you heard of it, C6. So it's an enormous success in the area of biotechnology. So, like, if you want to do something, I think there's scope for grants, and it's pretty high now in India.
Okay. Ma'am, another question is, what is the scope of pharmaceutical sciences?
Pharmaceutical sciences. Pharmaceutical scientists, like if you have done the post graduation, you can always get into this. All these pharma companies have an R&D unit. I worked in the R&D unit of AstraZeneca. It's one of the big pharma companies of the world. Thermo Fisher and many pharma companies, they have R&D unit. You can go into the drug discovery research, and all this, big pharma companies can. There are plenty of companies which employ the pharma graduates. I would say it's pretty good.
Okay. Ma'am, another question is, are any internship programs are being offered by your company or other companies?
Actually, we don't do internship because it takes a lot of our human power and our time. But we do run training programs. In our company, we don't take interns. But there are places where you can do internship. There are companies. And the JNU, like a Jawaharlal Nehru University for Advanced Research in Bangalore, and NCBS, National Center for Biological Sciences in Bangalore, they all run internship program. Especially during summer, it's very competitive. You need to apply and then you have to write an exam. But usually they run it during summer and it's very good. And who is the advisor, scientific advisor for our Prime Minister Narendra Modi is Dr. Vijay Ravan. He was the director for NCBS before. So NCBS is one of the very renowned research institutes in India. It's a part of the SBI for Mumbai. So even Indian Institute of Science, IISc, they run a summer internship program. So usually during, May, during this time only, they are usually advertised. But this year it might have been delayed or something. So you have to look out in their website.
Okay. Ma'am, is there any online courses offered by Biocon?
I don't think. They run a training program for hands-on training for industrial biotechnology.
Okay. This is a question from Mr. Ramesh. What is the main stigma that you need in students if they have to come up in life against all the odds?
Okay. Okay. I would say the attitude. When you approach any opportunity, you need to have a big picture in mind. And also never give up. So when I entered, when we started our company, the Chromos Biotech, in 2011, So people, especially, you know, my friends were saying there are sharks out there. They'll eat you up alive. You know, you need to have an aggressive attitude and you need to have this, that and all that, you know. But I said, when they said there are sharks out there, I said there are dolphins also in the ocean, you know. You see the dolphins, like, you know, despite the sharks being around, it manages have to have fun and it leads a good life, right? So you need to have an attitude like, you know, no matter what, I'm going to do this. And that is one thing. And then never give up. Never, ever give up on your, you know, your dreams or whatever you want to do.
And mom, another few more questions. Do pharma students, the pharma companies, do they take up MSc students?
Yeah, definitely. Definitely.
Okay.
So, see, the pharma, because, you know, we need a whole lot of, the pharma companies need a whole lot of life science graduate, either for, you know, doing research or for manufacturing. So they prefer fresh graduates, life sciences graduate, postgraduate especially, because they can train them on job. And, you know, the team leaders are usually PhDs. But you need a whole team of life sciences graduate to get the job done, right? So for manufacturing or research, the pharma companies employs, you know, a lot of, in fact, they prefer fresh graduates rather than PhDs, because the positions for PhDs are very, very less in industry. And so for graduates, there are a lot of pharma companies, of course, they employ life sciences graduates.
Okay. And ma'am, what is the scope of PhD in oncology? How valuable is it in the future?
Oncology, like we are becoming, you know, specialized. It's like your ENT doctor or eye specialist or a cancer specialist. So you're being a oncology, like you're being a cancer specialist in the area of life technology, life sciences, right? Yes. So where would you get either in the industrial, in the pharma company which works on cancer, or in the academics, like where you can generate your own project funds, right? So the more you go on specializing, the options get limited. And if you want to do a specialization, I would say the person need to be in academia. Because at one point, you know, we can't work only on cancer alone, right? So,
sorry to interrupt you, ma'am. And one last question. What is the scope of animal science in industrial sector?
Animal science, you mean veterinary sciences?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, especially in industry, it is pretty high, because for any you know, drug discovery group or pharma company, they will do animal experiments, right? So for all the, you know, pharma company which does the drug trials and all that, they employ veterinary science graduates or the animal sciences graduates for that. So especially it comes in handy for animal research. They can develop animal model for, you know, therapeutics.
Okay. And ma'am, the questions are, there are so many questions being posted. Another few questions. What is the scope of zoology mainstream person to become a professor in future?
Yeah, a professor, like you need to do your PhD, and then, you know, and then pass through this UGC NET. So that's the pathway to follow to be a professor.
Yes, ma'am. And one last question: A participant wants to know about a BSc cardiology jobs.
There is a BSc cardiology, is it?
Right, ma'am. BSc cardiology and jobs for them.
Okay. I'm going to tell again, you know, the more you specialize, your chances are limited to that particular area. It's like asking eye specialist. You will go to a, when your eye hurts, you will go to eye specialist, right? You will not go to a ENT or a cancer specialist, right? So it's like, so when you do your BSc cardiology, as such, you know, I would always suggest undergraduate in life sciences has very less scope. You, at least you have to be a postgraduate.
Okay.
If not PhD, like post-graduation, at least it is essential. So with the BSc, I'll say where the chances are very less.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for your patience. It was really enlightening, and your experience and knowledge was highly motivating our participants. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you. And thank you for the opportunity to interact. And I wish you all the success and may your dreams come true.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thanks. Bye.
I would like to give a reminder about tomorrow's talk. Dr. Ramanathan Vairamani, Chief Technology and Innovation, Rallis India Limited, will join us to present on the effects of genetically engineered crops on health. We will connect with you all tomorrow. Thank you.